University, whose cooperative education program allows students to explore future careers and discover their ideal profession before graduation. More on experiential education at drexel.edu.
This is WNYC 93.9 FM and AM 820, NPR News and the New York Conversation.
Marketplace is supported by AlterX, the analytics cloud platform with enterprise-ready AI to help organizations drive better decisions faster. More at alterx.com.
It's been a while, I think, since we've had a good bond market story. We'll take care of that today. From American Public Media, this is Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Drexel University, whose model of experiential education infuses academics with real experience, yielding impactful results. More at drexel.edu. And by Raymond James, tailored wealth management, banking, and capital markets solutions for clients' unique needs. Disclosures at raymondjames.com. And by Bitwarden. The Bitwarden password manager enables quick and easy logins through biometric unlock and password autofill. More at bitwarden.com.
In Los Angeles, I'm Kai Rizdal. It is Tuesday today, the third day of October. Good as always to have you along, everybody. We begin today with a word and a number. The number is 4.81, as in 4.81%. The word is bond, as in treasury bond. You put those two together and you know where I'm going, right? If you're taking out a mortgage or buying a car or applying for a credit card, 4.8-ish percent isn't so bad. If you're borrowing trillions and trillions of dollars, it's pretty bad. The yield on the 10-year treasury, which, by way of reminder, is the interest that the United States pays to borrow money over 10 years, hit 4.81% today, the highest it's been since 2007. And the thing is that when it gets more expensive for the government to borrow money, that changes a whole lot of things in this economy. Marketplace's Matt Levin has our lead.
You know how some offices do March Madness brackets or Academy Awards pools? Well, the fixed income team at the investment firm BlackRock has a version of that. At the beginning of the year, they guess what the yield on the 10-year T-note will be on December 31st.
I know what you're going to ask next. I will admit it. I had predicted that 10-year yields would finish the year probably closer to 3%.
Steve Lipley co-heads listed fixed income funds for BlackRock. Back in January, he thought the Fed's fight with inflation would basically be done by now and interest rates would be headed down. Needless to say, Lipley won't be winning.
The Federal Reserve speakers have come out in chorus, and some of them have been quite hawkish in their statements that, you know, they may need additional hikes.
When the Fed raises rates or investors think it'll leave rates higher for a while, yields on Treasury bonds go up. But Jay Powell is only part of the equation. Michael Kudzel with the investment firm PIMCO says the market for Treasury bonds is not immune to supply and demand.
Supply is massive today.
Through the first 11 months of fiscal year 2023, the federal government ran a deficit of $1.5 trillion. New debt onto the market that needs buyers.
These levels of debts are quite high.
And if you're like, well, that debt is Congress's problem, Bill English at the Yale School of Management has some bad news for you, or anyone who uses credit.
So it's going to be more expensive in terms of mortgage payments to buy a house, more expensive in terms of car payments to buy a car.
Because even though Congress is, well, Congress, global investors still think the U.S. federal government is a very safe place for their money. That's why the rate on the 10-year T-note is the benchmark for lots of other loans. If you're going to borrow in this market, you're going to pay higher rates. But English says it's not all downside for U.S. consumers.
So higher rates in the U.S. make dollar investments attractive. So the dollar becomes stronger, imports become cheaper.
A strong dollar also means a good time to travel abroad. Just don't finance the trip with a credit card. I'm Matt Levin for Marketplace.
On Wall Street today, to quote my friend Matt Levin, Congress is, well, Congress. And while traders certainly had one eye on the constitutional goings-on down in Washington, speaker is second in line for the presidency after all, that wasn't this. We'll have the details when we do the numbers. Imagine you're a labor economist, and the Bureau of Labor Statistics tells you that in August, there were more than 9.5 million job openings in this economy, up a bit from July and a bit more than people had been expecting. It's their regular job openings and labor turnover survey. JOLTS is the acronym. We've talked about it before. Anyway, you see that number. What do you say?
Nothing amazing, nothing alarming.
Catherine Ann Edwards is, in fact, a labor economist.
We are looking at this report looking for a sense of, is this just hires and quits and openings going back down to normal levels? But of course, it can be really hard for us to determine what a normal level is right now.
Because?
The survey wasn't designed to figure out in the middle of an extraordinarily tight labor market, in the middle of an inflation fight, when we're, you know, on very tenuous ground of a soft landing, if this is the exact number of job openings and quits we want to have. That's not why it was designed.
Or if I might paraphrase, things are weird right now. Elise Gould is a senior economist at the Economic Policy Institute.
So when I look at what is happening, what we saw in the data this morning, we did see this tick up in job openings, but everything else has been moving along very steadily.
And about that tick up,
one thing that really stands out is it happened in one particular sector. So in professional and business services, so it's not only that you only saw this one metric moving, you actually saw it moving in a very specific way. And so that will be something to watch.
So what are they watching come next month? Catherine Edwards?
Quits and hires. A mismatch in the quits and hires rate.
Say more on that, would you?
If you have a churn, they'd be at relatively similar levels, right? You have quits and hires kind of at pace with each other because people are switching jobs.
But, because there's always a but.
If we start to see separations without hires and pulling back on hiring, I think, to a level which is not good, that is what we are worried about.
Well, I think what we've seen over the last, let's say, 18 months is a pretty steady decline in job openings.
That's Elise Gould.
We're looking for, is there trouble coming? Or is there overheating? Neither of those things are the data telling us in the report that came out today.
In a nutshell, if I might, the labor market is slowing in a nice, orderly way, just the way the Fed wants. Just about 3 months ago, one of the biggest trucking companies in the country, Yellow Freight, based out of Nashville, Tennessee, filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. 30,000 people lost their jobs. Most of them, 20,000 or so, were unionized, which is rare in trucking. Most freight carriers aren't union shops. And now, even though they are in high demand, because the supply chain doesn't run all by itself, you know, some of the drivers coming from Yellow Freight are having a hard time finding work. Nashville Public Radio's Mariana Bacchiao has more.
In the months before Yellow's closure, its relationship with the Teamsters Union had already soured. The company was behind on its payments to employees' health benefits, and after missing an extended deadline to pay up, the Teamsters Union had threatened to strike. Tracy Cullen drove for Yellow for nearly 40 years.
And so we were going to strike. Well, at the last 11th hour, lo and behold, they suddenly said, okay, we've got the money.
But drivers like Cullen will never see the benefits the company promised. Soon after, Yellow announced it was shutting down and in a statement said the union was to blame. Now, Cullen and thousands of other truck drivers have to do something many haven't done in a while.
Hey, start beating the street, knocking on doors, trying to get a job. You know, and this is Tennessee. It's going to be hard to get a union job.
Yellow drivers typically earned more than their non-union counterparts. Tennessee, along with 27 other states, has right-to-work laws, which forbid mandatory union dues. It also can divide a workforce.
Between union members and non-union members.
That's Dan Cornfield, an expert on unionization at Vanderbilt University. He says that's important because it means the union has less bargaining power.
Not all the workers would be expected to honor the picket line.
Theoretically, it should be easier for truck drivers to unionize, Cornfield says, because it's one of the few jobs in the labor sector that can't be fully automated or outsourced right now. There's also a shortage of drivers, which should give the ones looking for work an edge in the market. Anthony Norwood is with Saia Freight's Human Resources. He says his company is hiring.
We certainly invite Yellow and former drivers and other drivers to apply and seek opportunities with us.
Norwood's company might be willing to hire Yellow drivers, but others don't seem so keen. That may be why some Yellow drivers are having a hard time landing new jobs, including Chris Dowdy. He thinks it's because companies don't want to hire former union members like him.
I was told by two companies, straight up, by two companies, they said if you had not worked for Yellow, I would hire you tomorrow.
Dowdy spent a month out of work and even longer without a paycheck. He says he sent out dozens of applications.
And that's the thing that has been boggling my mind. Because back in the day when I came in, like when dinosaurs roamed the earth, you were fired on Friday, you were hired on Monday.
While Dowdy was looking for work, his wife took on a second job to pay the bills.
I mean, a lot of us guys, like myself, we take pride in what we do, and we have pride in taking care of our family and making sure our family's needs are met.
Dowdy was ultimately able to find work that was both within a union and local. He's now driving for the grocery chain Kroger. But he says he's one of the lucky ones. Many of the drivers he worked with at Yellow are still searching for their next job. In Nashville, I'm Mariana Bacayao for Marketplace.
I said a minute ago, talking about trucking, that the supply chain in this economy doesn't run all by itself. Trucking, yes, of course. Also, warehouses, which I mentioned because we got a read on the state of the warehousing industry this morning by way of the Logistics Managers Index, which showed warehousing utilization, literally companies putting stuff on the shelves, rose at the fastest pace in 6 months. So Marketplace's Justin Ho got on the phone today with some businesses to see how they're feeling about warehousing right now.
Over the last few years, figuring out how much product to store in a warehouse has been like watching a wild pendulum.
We had no goods, then we had too much goods, then it swung back to, you know, emptying your warehouse out and putting everything on sale.
That's Pat Whalen, who handles imports at Sahadi Fine Foods, a grocery store in Brooklyn. He says a few months ago, he was trying to keep his warehouses lean, but now he's filling them up because he's got a busy few months ahead.
Christmas, Thanksgiving, they're food holidays.
Thing is, Whalen says he isn't over-ordering like he did early in the pandemic when supply chains were really congested. One reason?
It costs you a lot more to carry inventory today than it did this time last year and a lot more than it did 2 years ago. But you still have to have something.
The price of warehousing has been rising in part because a lot of new warehouses are opening up in metro areas, and those are relatively more expensive to build in, says Zach Rogers at Colorado State University, who puts together the Logistics Managers Index. Rogers says larger companies can afford to pay those higher warehousing prices, but smaller retailers might be more hesitant because they've learned that inventory might not sell.
The small companies got so hurt last year by having too much inventory on hand that they're sort of, I think, scarred by it and are terrified to build inventories up too high.
That said, some retailers are also terrified of not having enough product on hand.
I think after the shortages during the pandemic, I've just tried to make sure I'm not in a position where I'm running low or running out of something.
That's Catherine Reynolds, who handles imports for Palmetto Tile Distributors in South Carolina. She's been keeping her warehouses full of tile to meet demand, since a lot of homeowners are deciding to go ahead with renovations.
We have a lot of ongoing projects that are just starting to hit. They've been in the planning stages for a year or so.
And since Reynolds imports most of her tile from Europe, she wants to ensure she's protected in case her supply chains become congested again. I'm Justin Ho for Marketplace.
Coming up.
These platforms prioritize traffic above good taste.
It's all about the clicks, right? First, though, let's do the numbers. Yeah, the Wawa's. Dow Industrial's down 430 points today, 1.3%, 33,002. The NASDAQ off 248, that's almost 1.9%, 13,059. The S&P 500 gave back 58 points, 1.3%, 42.29. Airbnb down 6.5% today after a downgrade from KeyBank, which said the short-term rental company's margins would be squeezed as post-pandemic travel demand continues to soften. Drug maker Eli Lilly weakened 2.4%. The company announced it's planning to buy cancer treatment developer Point Biopharma in a deal worth about $1.4 billion. Point Biopharma jumped 85% almost. Facebook parent company dipped 1.9% today. That's after reports it's considering charging Facebook and Instagram users in the European Union a $14 monthly fee to access both platforms without advertising. $14. We report, you decide. Bonds down, yield on the 10-year T-note closed at 4.79%. You're listening to Marketplace.
The Marketplace Numbers segment is supported by Odoo, simple management software for all your business needs. Marketplace is supported by West Monroe, presenting This is Digital. The third season of the podcast goes behind the scenes with diverse leaders to reveal how digital shows up in the decisions that companies make every day. This is Digital is available across podcast apps. And by Amazon Business. From small business to big enterprise and everything in between, Amazon Business helps simplify the supplies buying process. Amazon Business, your partner for smart business buying. And by Vinovest, a wine and whiskey investing platform designed to help people grow their wealth beyond the stock market. Vinovest.co, dedicated to helping investors see real results with real assets.
Support for WNYC comes from Apple TV Plus, presenting Lessons in Chemistry. Brie Larson stars as Elizabeth Zott, a chemist who ends up with her own cooking show, proving life doesn't follow a formula, based on the novel by Bonnie Garmus. Streaming October 13th, only on Apple TV Plus.
On the next Brian Lehrer Show, we often think about how technology changes the content of our lives, but it also changes us physically. Manu Samarodi, who you know is the host of NPR's TED Radio Hour, discusses her new project on our computer's impact on our bodies. Also, what do you spend money on that your immigrant parents never would? And other questions from the co-founders of the group, the Mashup Americans. The Brian Lehrer Show, weekdays at 10 a.m. on WNYC.
You're listening to Marketplace on WNYC. Coming up in the 7 o'clock hour, of all things considered a historic first, House Speaker Kevin McCarthy is voted out of the job. What comes next? Who will be the next speaker? We'll have that and more at 7 o'clock. Stay with us.
This is Marketplace. I'm Kai Rizdahl. Baseball's postseason starts today, if the World Series goes to 7 games, by the way. It'll be the 4th of November before all's said and done. But this is, indeed, the start of the very long home stretch of a season that's brought big changes, a whole host of ways to spice up the action on the field, and not coincidentally, turn around a long-term decline in attendance. The biggest new thing, of course, is the pitch clock, trying to make what can, honestly, be longer than they ought to be games, just a little bit shorter. And it worked. This year, MLB had more fans in the seats than it has since 2017. And on average, games were 24 minutes shorter. As Marketplace's Henry App reports, that is a big deal for a tradition-bound sport looking to build a new generation of fans.
Full disclosure, I was one of the 70 million plus people who paid to see a Major League Baseball game this summer. Me and 30-some thousand other fans packed into Target Field in Minneapolis in late July to watch the Minnesota Twins beat the Chicago White Sox. We drank beer, ate hot dogs, saw some home runs, did the wave. And the game only lasted 2 hours and 20 minutes. Victor Matheson is a professor of economics at the College of the Holy Cross.
In a world where your time is valuable, people like the idea of getting an entire baseball game in at about 30 minutes less than it was the year or two before.
Matheson says shorter games don't tell the whole story. A big part of the jump in attendance may be that post-pandemic revenge spending we've been reporting on.
We saw vacation travel go way up. We saw good attendances at things like music concerts. Obviously, things like Taylor Swift setting all sorts of records.
Another recent change that may have boosted attendance, more teams make the playoffs, says Brian Mills, an associate professor at the University of Texas.
So there's more reason to go to those games because they may impact whether or not your team makes the playoffs.
There was also the World Baseball Classic right before the MLB season started. That once every 4 years tournament typically boosts interest in the sport for a few months, says Khalid Baluli, an associate professor at the University of South Carolina.
I think the bigger question will be, what happens to attendance next year, right?
But the effort to shorten games is aimed at sustaining the sport well beyond next year, says Brian Mills of the University of Texas, by making going to the ballpark more kid-friendly.
I think as folks realize that games aren't going till 1 a.m. every single night, they may be more likely to bring their, you know, 5-, 6-, 7-year-old kid to the stadium downtown.
He says the league hopes those kids will get hooked and eventually grow into adult fans who, like me, are willing to spend way too much of their time and money on baseball. I'm Henry Eth for Marketplace.
What happens to somebody's social media accounts, or more broadly, their entire digital footprint after they've passed, isn't something we've got completely figured out. But there is a related question that honestly hadn't even occurred to me. What happens when your digital presence grows after you pass? Kate Nibbs is a senior writer at Wired, and she's been covering the strange world of YouTube obituary pirates. Kate, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
I need you to, first of all, we have to establish some phraseology here. YouTube obituary pirates, what are they?
YouTube obituary pirates are a bit of a mystery to me to this day. They are people who upload videos of themselves summarizing the obituaries of strangers. They just turn on their cell phone camera and explain someone else's obituary and then upload it. And as far as I can tell, it's a money-making scheme, although I don't know how much money they're making off of it.
So you answered my next question right there. They're doing this to make money, I imagine.
It certainly seems that way. I've tried to contact them. I haven't successfully had conversations, but it's several of the more popular YouTube obituary pages were ad-supported. So I was watching pre-roll from like Etsy and Harry and David and a few other companies before I could get to the obituary videos. So yeah, right. They're successful enough that they are able to generate at least some revenue off of advertising.
Okay, got it. Now, how did you come to this story?
A friend of mine texted me and asked me if I'd ever heard of YouTubers who make a living by reciting obituaries. And he had come to the story in a very sad way. An old childhood friend of his had passed away, and he found at least 10 of these videos of random, mainly men, just reciting facts about her. And he was so unsettled by it that he wanted to learn more, and I did what I could to get some answers for him.
So this is, it's obviously deeply hurtful and troubling to friends and relatives of those who have passed. And it's shady and creepy and all those kinds of things. But I wonder if it says something about the incentives we have on the internet in this society, right? That's kind of what this is about.
Absolutely. I do think that the people who are making these videos are acting callously towards the bereaved. It's quite a tasteless pursuit, but it seems as though it's a pursuit driven by desperation, like they are casting around looking for ways to make money online. And it's because these platforms prioritize traffic above good taste, and it results in strange cottage industries like this.
Are obituary pirates a new thing and technology is just sort of exacerbating it, or have these been around for a while?
The YouTube element of it is fairly new. That's cropped up in the last few years. But obituary pirating has actually been around since obituaries went online. There is this whole other cottage industry where people looking to make a quick buck would basically plagiarize legitimate obituaries that were posted online by local newspapers or legacy.com. They'd create their own like obituary repositories online and try to divert the web traffic. And Some of the companies that have been doing this have actually seen some repercussions because it was straight plagiarism. But the YouTubers get around any legal repercussions because they're summarizing the obituaries. Even though it's a really messed up thing to do, it's technically probably legal. They could likely successfully use like the fair use doctrine to protect themselves from any legal liabilities.
What did YouTube have to say?
They didn't have that much to say about it. I think they didn't end up commenting. I also reached out to some of the companies whose advertisements I'd seen, and none of them wanted to comment on the record either. It seems like something everyone involved would prefer to not exist.
Right. You watched, I imagine, a bunch of these in reporting this story. What's your takeaway?
Yeah, I don't know. The whole thing is really twisted, and it's definitely made me think about how when I die, there's almost certainly going to be like 10 to 15 strangers across the world emotionlessly reciting the facts of my death. Yeah.
Well, of course, it'll be a while and AI will get involved, right, somehow. And then there's going to be that whole dynamic.
Oh, I mean, I'm actually surprised I didn't find AI-generated obituary pirating going on already. I feel a little worried that I'm speaking it into existence right now because it seems like a natural extension of the scam to like remove the already minimal human effort that's involved.
Kate Nibbs, she's a senior writer at Wired. The most recent piece, which is, the title says it all, The Bizarre Cottage Industry of YouTube Obituary Pirates. Kate, thanks a lot. I appreciate your time.
Thanks for having me.
This final note on the way out today, maybe Macy's was listening yesterday, the story Elizabeth Trovall did about strip malls and how key they can be for parts of this economy, small businesses in particular. The big retailer said this week it's going to open 30 stores in strip malls across the country over the next couple of years. No locations given, but the company is trying to meet customers and consumers where they are, which increasingly is not in malls.
Marketplace is supported by C3 AI. C3 Generative AI provides ChatGPT enterprise search that is verifiable, secure, and accurate across all enterprise data. C3.AI. This is enterprise AI. And by Fidelity. A dedicated Fidelity advisor can help create a wealth plan for a full financial picture. Investment minimums apply. Fidelity Brokerage Services, LLC.
All right, we got to go. Here is your moment of economic context in which failure to control your space debris will cost you. The Federal Communications Commission has fined Dish Network $150,000 for not moving one of its defunct satellites out of the way of others. Satellites that are working. Our digital and on-demand team includes Carrie Barber, Dylan Mietinen, Janet Wynn, Olga Oxman, Ellen Rolfes, Virginia K. Smith, and Tony Wagner. Francesca Levy is the executive director of digital and on-demand. And I'm Kai Rizdahl. We will see you tomorrow, everybody. This is APM.